Turn in your Bibles to Revelation. Well, we've studied quite a few of these doctrines in Revelation. Now, the first thing we want to ask you, we'll see how your understanding is on this subject, and if you're right, how many think that President Bush and our government and our leaders and the coalition will change and allow Hussein to pull out of Kuwait and still maintain his leadership in Iraq? Raise your hands. Nobody? How many do not think that we would let him pull out of Kuwait to end the war? You raise your hand. Okay. As always, most people aren't even thinking. Okay. Now, Revelation 5, we have gone into this in two classes now. Now, we will read verses 8 to 11. We've gone into the doctrine of worship. We've gone into the principle of the seals. We've gone into the tribe of Judah background of Jesus Christ as a victor, and we've gone into the Lamb principle. Verse 8, and when he had taken the scrolls, or the scroll book, the four living creatures and the 24 elders, we've explained several times who they were, of the heavenly Sanhedrin, prostrated themselves before the Lamb. Each was holding a harp, lute, or guitar, and they had a golden bowls full of incense, fragrant spices, and gums for burning, which are the prayers of God's people, the saints. Now they sing a new song, saying, you are worthy to take the scroll and to break the seals thereon on it. You were slain, sacrificed, and with your blood you purchased men unto God from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom, a royal race, and priests to our God. And they shall reign as kings over the earth. Then I looked, and I heard the voices of many angels on every side of the throne. Now you'll notice verse 11 very explicitly goes into angels. It doesn't call them beasts anymore. And it doesn't call them beings. It calls them angels on every side of the throne. And of the living creatures and the elders of the heavenly Sanhedrin. So we have the angels, the living creatures, and the elders. And actually the angels and elders were living creatures. And they numbered, idiom of speech, innumerable, 10,000 times 10,000, and thousands of thousands, saying in a loud voice, deserving is the Lamb that was sacrificed to receive all power and riches and wisdom and might and honor and majesty, glory, splendor, and blessing. Now, verse 12, we're not going to get into. That will take an entire class. Verse 12 will take an entire class. So we're not getting into that this morning. I do not think we will. Now, we are dealing with a very wonderful book. Now you know who the four beasts are. Now you know who the 24 elders are. Now you're getting the word angels being used instead of living beings all around the throne. Why? Because they're consummating their understanding of redemption when they were never redeemed, a carryover and consummation of 1 Peter 1:12 and 1 Corinthians 4:9 in the angelic conflict. Now they sang, or rather they sung, I'm sorry, they sung a new song. Verse 9, they sung, kai adu, present active indicative, the old verb which means to sing with lyrical emotions. It's also a principle in Colossians 3:16, where doctrine is used to teach, to admonish, to bless, to motivate. Now, we spoke just about 5 minutes this morning to the businessmen over here on the subject of motivation versus stimulation. And we've been approaching that subject somewhat this week. Stimulation. Stimulation is not completely limited in any way to the old sin nature, but it plays a large role in the life of the old sin nature. Stimulation. Stimulation relates, at least to some degree, to the old sin nature's construct or structure. Now, the old sin nature's construct is made up of an initiational department. Say it back to me. Initiational department. In other words, the old sin nature has to initiate in order to reproduce its nature. So it is called an initiational what? Department, which is part of the old sin nature's what? Construct. Isn't that simple? Old sin nature's construct, initiational process that goes on in a department of that construct. Now, the old nature, I reiterate, has to reproduce through initiation because of its need to reproduce its rights. To reproduce its needs. Its so-called rights and its so-called needs. Now, the old sin nature has a tremendous need to preserve itself, to preserve its ego in Adam, and to establish self-preservation of essence. And there is a whole department within the construct of the old sin nature that has the entire purpose of self-preservation. Now, self-preservation, by virtue of what it means and what it is, by necessity, has to have a self-defense department. A self-defense department. So now we have, say it back to me, a self-defense apartment. I mean, America wants to preserve freedom, preserve its national entity, and we have a defense apartment. It's doing a very good job right now, thanks to Reagan in the 8 years he was in office, bringing up the military budget to $286 billion out of our $1 trillion national budget. Now, thanks to Reagan and his initiation, we have a wonderful current defense department. But the old sin nature has a self-defense department. Now, how does that work for you? Well, you don't understand the working. I don't understand the working of this construct. But It is aggressive. It likes to reproduce its rights. It wants its needs to be fulfilled. And by necessary or by necessity, it has to have a defense department, and that reproduces the self-defense mechanisms within us. Now that causes us to also be or have ready to go, if necessary, a reactionary cycle where we react when anything that we are preserving is threatened. So we are very capable of either spontaneous reaction or delayed reaction, which has a little bit more human wisdom to regulate the delay. Then the reactionary process is followed by a rebellion premise. A rebellion against that would threaten the construct. But there are certain things that stimulate the old sin nature. The old sin nature also, even though it is humanly speaking depraved and a fallen nature, it is also very religious. And remember, John 1:9 speaks of the moral light that lights up every man. That moral light that lights up every man, or King James calls it a light that lights up every man, information pertaining to God consciousness prior to salvation. Information pertaining to God consciousness prior to salvation. Without any definition, but nevertheless, a God-conscious constitutional witness. Now, the old sin nature then, with the moral light now malfunctioning, still leaves it to be religious, so that Adam and Eve will immediately sow the fig leaves to cover the nakedness. That was the first step in the religious act of the old sin nature, to not be guilty and to take away shame before its own eyes. Now the old sin nature, therefore, will often crusade for God. It'll often make strange statements for God because of its zealous religious nature to preserve its human goodness. You see, it does want to preserve its human goodness, though it may fall into deep sin to meet the need that it has in one of its departments. But the old sin nature is frequently stimulated, and it functions on the basis of stimulation, and the activity of stimulation promote its self-worth to the individual. Now we have the new nature, and we consistently feed, hopefully, the new nature. The new nature which we nourish, which we cherish, which we expose to light, life and light. The new nature which we consistently should be developing, that has the greatest privilege of all to live in divine motivation. You get up in the morning and you're motivated, if you're spirit conscious, by God's life within you. God's life within you motivates you. The Holy Spirit's love in the heart motivates us. The divine plan motivates us. The eternal purpose motivates us. The needs of mankind through Jesus Christ in us motivates us. The integrity of God motivates us. The cleansing from all sin so that we're free from guilt and condemnation leaves us readily and easily motivated. And we are divinely speaking motivated. Now in this, in Job, God gets much pleasure out of the prosperity of his servant. Now his servant, Psalm 35:27, is deeply motivated. He's motivated consistently. He's motivated with content in his soul. He has content in his soul. And he's motivated by that content of life in his soul. And he's so motivated as a husband, as a father, as a friend, as a leader, as a teacher, as a believer priest. He's motivated because he has heaven motivating him. He has truth motivating him, and he has that beautiful principle of grace and love and mercy and life motivating him. So in 2 Corinthians 5:14, 15, 16, 17, 18, he is highly motivated. He has a motivation that isn't regulated by sight. He has a motivation that itself isn't limited by circumstances. He has a motivation that is not stifled by feelings. He has a motivation that is not inhibited by incompatible relationships. He has a motivation that is not conditional in time or weather or economy or sickness. He is highly motivated by Jesus Christ. The outside, external confrontations can come from everywhere, but he is motivated, and the Holy Spirit and the kingdom of God motivates him. Why is this? Because God has made him to be kings, made them to be kings and priests. Kings and priests. Now, we have this great principle that God says, listen, the oldest in the family will be a leader in the family and be very responsible, and he will act as a priest. Then God took the principle of the priesthood into the Levitical priesthood of Aaron, and they would be priests over a nation. And then God in the New Testament age brings in the order of the believer priest under the new covenant of grace and the finished work, where he makes all believers kings and priests. Now the question is, when Jesus Christ in Hebrews 5:6, 7:1, 7:17, Jesus Christ is our royal priest. And Jesus Christ in 1 Peter 2:5 and 9 has made us members of that royal priesthood. This priesthood is superior to all other priesthoods. Now, it's based upon the fact that Jesus Christ won a strategic victory in the battle of the ages, that he is a victor in the angelic conflict, and in Hebrews 6:17-20, therefore he functions in his amazing royalty as priest over sinners saved by grace to God in their behalf. Therefore he gives us through his priesthood a tactical victory. Now, if we were to consider a tactical victory, we would realize that we absolutely have secured strategic objectives. We have secured strategic objectives. And in the art, this principle in warfare is the art of deploying and directing one's forces against the enemy. It deals with the matters of arrangements. Well, God has given us a tactical victory. We have secured strategical objectives. And these principles motivate us. Motivate us. Think of the last time you were depressed over anything. When was the last time you were anxious? When was the last time you lost your ability to appropriate a tactical victory as you secured strategical objectives in your personal life? Well, sure, you had to use recovery and you had moments of momentary failure, or you had to adjust to recovery. But God's people are highly motivated. In Revelation 5:8, we have the consummation of a new understanding of Christ's victory in the glorified realm of the bodies that they were enjoying in heaven around the throne. Now, the priest in this New Testament era has received God's imputed righteousness, and with that he has all kinds of potential and possibilities and privileges because of that imputed righteousness. He has the possibilities beyond human imagination. Then as a priest, he's accountable to God for the whole counsel of God, but he functions toward God for people, for individuals in the plan of God. He must partake of the nature of those he represents. That was Jesus Christ in Hebrews 4. He was a partaker of being tempted such as we are, and he became a man even though he knew no sin. And then he was a partaker of all that we suffer. And we have empathy, identification, and oneness with others as we represent them as priests. We rejoice when they rejoice. We weep sometimes when they weep, or at least an attitude of oneness. And when they're honored, we're happy, and so on. And when they hurt, we care. In 1 Corinthians 12:26. That's a part of our priesthood. And with this empathy and identification, we function toward God for others in our priesthood. Of course, we have the privacy of our priesthood, where once we've heard the word of God, we have the absolute options of doing what we want to with it, whether we obey or disobey. That is our private right as priests before God, to stand or fall before Him. Now, all men do not have the priesthood status, although Christ died for all men. Now, in the Old Testament, in Numbers 16:3, in Leviticus 8:21, and 22:1-6 in Leviticus, then we had the order of priests, but of course then, all believers were not priests. Now we want you to see that God has not only given us the privilege to be priests unto Him, but this passage says in verse 10, He has made us also to be kings. Think of that for just a moment. He has made us to be kings. Now, in this principle of making us to be kings, the Word of God teaches in Revelation 1:6, 5:10, and 20 verse 6, basilia, kingdom, but it's in plurals, basilias, basileus, which means kings, a kingdom of kings and priests, or other words, a kingdom and priests. So here's God's people that understand that Jesus Christ in Jeremiah 10:7 is the king of history. And in Proverbs 16:3, he controls history. That's why the believer, though he's compassionate, understands things like wars. The kingdom of God is the sphere of God's rule in Psalm 22:28, Psalm 145:13. And Romans 13:2, even over kings and rulers he is king. and salvation in Romans 4:25. Jesus Christ is the King in the sphere of God's rule. Now then, Jesus Christ has made us an order of kings in his kingdom. Now the purpose of this, once we were born into that kingdom in John 3:5, once we understand that the Lord says you enter into that kingdom in 2 Thessalonians 1:5, sometimes in persecution, when you enter in, it's in persecution. But in that kingdom, we have grace that is so precious that the believer receives that grace and reigns through righteousness by the King of Kings, Jesus Christ. So the believer reigns by grace through God's righteousness given to him as a great potential for his amazing future assets. And we reign, and therefore we indeed understand that the wicked one cannot touch God's kingdom, and we are overcomers in the plan, in the eternal purpose, with provision and with great protection and with amazing power. God has made us to be kings, despite the rebellion in the world and the resistance toward God's kingdom. Revelation 11:15-18 says that God has sovereignty over the world despite its rebellion. He's declared his purpose in Daniel 2:44 and 7:16, his ultimate victory in 1 Corinthians 15:24 and 25. Now, what is God seeking in order to promote his king, his priests that make up his kingdom, that he is sent to be ambassadors? He is seeking their faith obedience in Romans 1:5. And it has to be a faith obedience. The evidence of things hoped for, the substance of things not yet seen. A faith obedience. A faith obedience is the first quality and characteristic of a king in God's kingdom. He gives his words, his doctrine, first to Israel in 1 Chronicles 28:5, and appointed them kings to administer his kingdom. In Isaiah 1:2-4, they rebelled. In John 1:11, they didn't receive him. In Matthew 21:33-34, they rebelled some more. And in Romans 11:15, they were put aside and cast away for the time being. Now, without distinction of race, nationality, God has asked individuals to submit voluntarily through salvation and through doctrine to this wonderful kingdom. And he wants individuals to begin to realize that the kingdom starts, the reign starts in the heart of the believer in Acts 4:19, Ephesians 3:17, and 1 Peter 3:15. The king is acknowledged in the heart, and the king is acknowledged in the churches in 1 Corinthians 12:3 and 5:1 and 14-37. So we have a kingdom made up of kings and made up of priests. Now, that is all theological data. I want to share something with you now. God has commanded me to have a certain mental attitude as a king and as a priest. A lot of people don't function in the kingdom. Reigning, they don't function as believer priests for others before God. We are kings. That's why we can afford to sacrifice. That's why I can afford to take my income and to to write right off the top and then to do things privately all over the place. I can afford to do that. I'm a king. And I have resources that the world doesn't have. I have resources that the unsaved people don't have. They may have more materialistic resources, but I have amazing resources for the plan. I have a provision, and it's invisible. I have a protection, and it's invisible. And I have a revelation from the Word of God that to the world is inaudible. So do you, and so do we all as Christians everywhere. Therefore, God commands us to have His mind. Let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ Jesus. That is an imperative mood. God says you're kings and priests, you're sealed, you're saved, you're sanctified, and of course you're being sanctified. But I command you to have the right attitude. Some of you men get moody every third week. Knock it off. God commands you not to be moody. God commands you not to be anxious. How do you like that? God commands you not to fear. God commands you to have His mind. Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. God commands you to have His mind. In 1 Corinthians 2:16, we have the mind of Christ. We have the mental attitude of Christ. Christ isn't worried about the people going to hell. He isn't worried about the children He created that have rebelled against Him and are up against Him. He loved them. He died for them. He'll help any of them. And He has a universal love because He is love. But Jesus Christ isn't fretting about that. He isn't withdrawing into His room, worried about our economy or Hussein. He's the King of nations, the controller of history, the head of the church, the royal priest. And Jesus Christ is absolutely confident and secure based upon His own attributes. And His integrity is based upon His attributes. And His attributes reveal His integrity. And He can never be anything but true to His integrity. His essence is revealed by His attributes. Set your mind on things above. Colossians 3:2. God said, I will not accept anything but my mind in you. Will you get this straight? It is an imperative move. Don't go around in your church acting weird, insecure, withdrawn. Come on! Be motivated by the cross. Be motivated. At Watchman Nee says, to grow in Christ means to get deeper in death so that you'll have all kinds of freedom of life. To grow means to get deeper in the death. It's time for men to be mature and products of the ascension, members of the kingdom. It's time for God's people to be priests with amazing ability in intercession, supplication, love, empathy, identification. God is saying, listen, I want you to understand that bring every single thought into subjection and into obedience to Jesus Christ. Now, that's the only time that a believer submits in blind obedience. The wife doesn't submit in blind obedience. The children that go to a local assembly don't submit in blind obedience. They have voluntary thinking, voluntary minds that operate in light. But as far as God goes, the word slave used for us before our God when truth is presented, we submit to the word of God when it's presented clearly in obedience without sight or even without rationale when it's illuminated in our spirit. Cast down every imagination and high thing that will exalt itself against the knowledge of God. Cast it down. And bring every single thought into captivity to the obedience of Jesus Christ, not to the obedience of your feeling, not to the obedience to your old sin nature's departments, bring every thought into obedience to Jesus Christ. That's what this is saying. Not in obedience to somebody's influence, not in obedience to your husband's or wife's ideas if they're not totally one with God. Bring every single thought into obedience to Jesus Christ and revenge all disobedience. If somebody says to some of you young people, hey, one of your buddies that you used to go drinking with, could you go out with me? You revenge that. You don't talk with him and act like you're his good friend. You revenge that. You revenge disobedience with what? Obedience. And you do it in all readiness. Well, glory be to God. 1 Peter 1:13 says, gird the loins of your mind. Be built up in categories. Be built up precisely. Be built up in specific divine thinking. Gird the loins of your mind. And that's an analogy of the spiritual thought life that we have. Be strong in your thoughts with God. 1 Peter 4:1 says, the original says to arm your mind with God's thoughts. To arm your mind with the same thoughts Jesus had. We are to be motivated with God's attitude, with God's thoughts, and with God's viewpoint on every single subject known to man. We're to learn and teach the new man consistently to grow in thinking with God as we begin to receive our daily benefits. Now, in Job 4:6, is not your fear of God your confidence? That's beautiful. Healthy fear, wholesome fear. Is not the fear of God your confidence? And then he goes on to say, and the integrity and uprightness of your ways, your hope, your integrity, because of your reverence in God, before God, your integrity, which reflects his mind, his nature, is your future hope. Your very integrity gives you faith in everything that God says, because it's based upon a reflection of God's veracity in Psalm 33:4, and you reflect it in 2 Corinthians 3:18 by the Spirit of God into a new principle of reflected glory. So here we have the great principle that fear is confident and hope is the integrity of our ways. We have integrity as we reflect God's glory. And this gives us an amazing principle of boldness and motivation as we live before our God. Well, Hebrews 12:15 warns us to consider him, lest we be weary and faint in our minds. Lest we be weary and faint in our minds. We need to have a picture in front of us that brings a very clear focus of our involvement in God's kingdom as kings and our involvement in his royal priesthood as priests. And it becomes a very special thing. Well, thanks be to God. As we close this morning, we want you to realize with us that Jesus Christ has so made us a kingdom of priests, and it's so genuine and it's so real and it's so alive that it becomes a motive of Colossians 3:16 to let the word of God dwell richly in our hearts, singing, teaching, psalms, hymns, spiritual songs, singing with grace in our hearts unto the Lord. And here in Revelation 5:8, they sung a brand new song. Here it is again. Another wonderful time when they're singing a new song. And it has to do with the redemption. It has to do with the blood. And it has to do with the worthiness of Christ, who's redeemed us to God by the blood out of every kindred, tongue, people, and nation. And here they are singing this new song, Psalm 98:1 says, sing to the Lord a new song. Every new act of mercy calls forth for a new song of praise. Not just a new in point of time, but new and distinct in quality. The word is kainos. And the word of God says it's new in nature. Better than the old, superior. It's a new song saying, thou art worthy. Present active indicative in the nominative case, axios I. The same description of worth is directed both to the one upon the throne and to the Lamb. 4:11, 5:9 of Revelation. Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for thou was slain, speaking of suffering in the aorist passive indicative. At a point of time, he received the action of dogmatic suffering from all of mankind. And the word here is used as someone or an animal that has been slaughtered. It is a gruesome word for killing. It means violent massacre or butchering. It's S-P-H-A-Z-O, spahazo. And it's used only in Revelation to describe the death of Christ, and has redeemed us to God. Aorist active indicative. In the dative case, he gave his life a ransom for many, for all. In 1 Timothy 2:6, he redeemed us, brought us out from the law. Galatians 3:13. And we are redeemed by his precious blood. In 1 Peter 1:9, we are bought with a price, and Jesus Christ bought us. So here he has this principle that he has redeemed us, not just by his spiritual death, which some people call a violent death. As men of God that are true to God say, violent death, in when it's referring to Christ, 55 times include the principle and analogy of a figurative literal principle based upon a literal premise of shedding blood. And the reason is this: God had to become a man. Number two, God had to be tempted such as we are in his humanity. Number three, God's flesh made God visible in human form. Number four, men have blood. Their sin is in the blood. Their blood makes them have their problems of sin because the life is in the blood. And therefore, the blood is sacred and precious because the blood that was in him didn't have an old sin nature. So spiritual death was imperative for 3 hours, and it was wonderful and marvelous when he was separated from God for 3 hours. But then when he said it is finished before he shed his blood, that did not mean that spiritual death was all that was required. It meant that in his humanity, he had exercised an entire life of surrendering to the Father. He had now become a lamb being slain. He was in the position for the final act. That's what that meant. And this thought that, okay, he finished it, and therefore he said it was finished before the shedding of the blood. Therefore, the blood wasn't necessary to be shed. That's erroneous, false, immature, and off. It's finished means that his humanity had done the job. He did everything he could in submitting, and here he is. He's not going to come down off the cross. He's been encouraged to by the Pharisees and scribes, but he's not going to do it. Now, he's finished. But it doesn't mean a finished work without blood. When the animal was killed on the altar, the blood had to be brought to the mercy seat every time, once a year in Leviticus 16. And the blood had to be shed. The blood had to be applied. First the death, a sacrificial animal, a substitute. Then the requirement of the death. Then the requirement of the blood. Then the requirement of the blood applied. That is true Christianity. That is true. And he redeemed us by his blood. Even though he was human, even though his blood was human, Acts 20:28 calls it the blood of God. That doesn't mean it wasn't human. It was human blood. But it was the blood of God because he was conceived of the Holy Spirit. Therefore, it was special blood, precious blood. It wasn't that his death had to be applied. It was the death and the blood that came out of a perfect life that never sinned, the life that was perfect, represented in the blood that never sinned, that had to be applied to the mercy seat so that when I see the blood, I will pass over you. I'm going to write about a 70-page booklet on this, and I'll go into it much better. This is just quickly expressing it again today, only in a matter of moments. But what were they singing a new song for? They redeemed us with his what?
Blood.
Why didn't they say they redeemed us with his death? 55 times the blood is literal, 385 times it is symbolic. But remember what the real scholars teach us, that the Bible is literal, but every time it gets figurative, it is literally figurative based upon a literal premise. Father, dismiss us in Jesus' name. Amen.